Friends, we have bhakti or prema or worship. When bhakti or devotion is translated into action, it is karma or worship. That same bhakti initially and throughout is prema. Prema yoga, bhakti yoga, karma yoga, jnana yoga, raja yoga are all interrelated. They are not watertight compartments. Everybody has a heart, and the heart has the feelings. The most important, essential, intrinsic, available feeling is love. That love is purified. It goes, rises, unfolds, becomes noble, divine, then it is a bhakti. And that bhakti, when translated into action, is called worship. Now, we have hundreds and thousands of people going to temples. Are they all bhakti yogis? There are many boys falling in love with girls. Are they all prema yogis? There are many girls loving the boys. Do they all be considered to be prema yogis or bhakti yogis? Bhakti is different. Bhakti yoga is different. Prema is different. Prema yoga is different. Karma is different. Karma yoga is different. Jnana is different, jnana yoga is different. You may be highly knowledgeable. You may know the truth, but you don't realize the Brahman. How many scholars are there capable of speaking wonderfully on the Vedic wisdom? Panditya Prakasha, show off their knowledge, knowledge of truth. And when they come to this stage, they quote from Bhagavad Gita, they recite Upanishads, and they speak of the Vedic wisdom. Sri Ramakrishna Paramahamsa beautifully says, an eagle soars high, flies high in the skies, but its looks are on the carrion or the dead body below. The great speakers of jnana have their ultimate interest in mind. That is the body center. Please try to understand, when we come to prashanti, we must have a clear demarcation, understanding of bhakti and bhakti yogi, jnana and jnana yoga, karma and karma yoga. Every action is karma, and that action, for the sake of action, worship for the sake of worship, is karma yoga. Love for the sake of love is bhakti. Knowledge for the sake of knowledge, nothing in return is expected. That is the major difference, bhakti, bhakti yogi. If all are bhakta yogis, country is wonderful. How many people are going to Sabarimala every day here? Hundreds of thousands of them. They are all bhaktas, not bhakta yogis. Lakhs of people are visiting Venkateshwara every day, and they are all bhaktas, not bhakta yogis. And there is an understanding between boys and girls. They all bhaktas, prema, lovers, loving yogis. No, they may be lovers, not prema yogis. What is that difference? Bhakti is three-dimensional. Three-dimensional means three dimensions, three aspects, three facets, three expressions. If you go to a cinema, it is one-dimensional. Only the screen and the screen, you have the pictures. You have a three-dimensional film. When you go to that film, if you find grapes, grapes appear to be coming to your mouth. If you see a dancer on the screen, the dancer appears to be coming to you, hugging you. That is three-dimensional. We would like to have the full thrill of prema, not only by looking, not only by touching, talking, not only by touching, but by merging with the person. That is full dimension. These three dimensions are, one is parinama bhakti, evolution, rise, growth, from the lowest to the highest. Two, it is bhavana bhakti. What attitude do you have while you fall in love with a girl or boy? Bhavana bhakti. Bhavana is your attitude. And then, how do you show your bhakti in action? Anusthana bhakti, practical. I frequently say, I was the principal of a co-education college. One day a girl student came and she made a complaint against a boy. That fellow, sir, who is that fellow? BSc senior student, sir. What does he do? Sir, every day, sir, 8:45, sir, when I come to the college, sir, he comes by my side, keeps distance, sir, about 1 foot, 2 feet, and he walks by my side. There are other boys, other girls. He even does not look at me. He walks straight and he says very gently, very intelligibly only to me, others cannot hear. And he says, I love you, and goes. Again in the library, when everybody is walking, I love you, and he goes. In the classroom, all of us are sitting, listening to the lectures, he will just look like that, I love you, and he will go. Morning till night, every time he says, I love you, I love you, I love you, at least 150 times. Do you want me to dismiss him? Issue PC and ask him to get out of the college? Then the girl says, no, sir. Why? I do love him, sir. Then what is the complaint? The fellow does not know how to say I love you. How do you want him to say? Sir, while coming to the college, there is a shop. He can buy a Cadbury chocolate and give you. Every day in the YIC class, teachers are giving me assignment, bore. The boy can say, don't worry, I will write all your assignments. He can wait. The love requires a tangible expression in service. Giving a Cadbury chocolate is to show your love. Writing an assignment is to show your love. You take flowers and worship God, show your love. You decorate the deity, show your love. You sweep the entire campus of the temple to show your love. You clean the entire country on the floor, Swachh Bharat, to show your love. I sing the Janaganamana to show my love. Love is abstract. Love cannot be seen. It can only be shown in action. When that love is shown in action, it is called anusthana bhakti. Swami Vivekananda wants everybody to be a practical devotee. Same is the case with knowledge, practical Vedanta. Your determination should be practiced. Your knowledge must be practiced. Your love must be practiced. When that practice comes, then we call it anusthana. Anusthana is practice, practical. Practical is karma. And as long as it remains abstract in the mind, it is only theoretical. Bhakti way is different, Bhakti yoga is different. When it is translated into action, even then, there are two things. Number one, I love because I have a desire. Remember that. All the people going to Lord Venkateshwara, you just try to probe deep into their minds. Venkateshwara, please give money. Please give increment. Please give promotion. Please see that I am married. Please see that I get the job. Desire, 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 desire. When our love is polluted with the desire, it's not bhakti yogi. Love is for the sake of love. One pollution, one contamination is desire. Two, fear. I have fear. If I don't go to Venkateshwara's temple, I may fail in the examination. I am afraid of the consequences. There are two powerful things in the mind. One is desire. The other is fear. These desires and fears make us devotees. When desire is absent, fear is absent, then it is love. Let us introspect. Let us examine ourselves. Are we really bhaktas, bhakta yogis? We are not yogis because our prayers are polluted by desires. They are haunted by fears. Fear and desire are the pollutants of devotion. As long as the devotion is polluted with these two, you may be called by the outside world a great bhakta, but not a yogi of devotion. There is a proverb in English. It may be familiarly known to you. Man pretends love to have sense pleasure, bodily pleasure from the wife or woman. He pretends to love because he has the desire for sense pleasure. He wants to enjoy the bodily pleasures. And what is the bait? He looks like a lover. He appears to love the girl. What he wants is the pleasure from her body. Woman gives the sense pleasure, offers the bodily pleasure to win the man's love. Exceptions are many. Man and woman, major difference, generally observed difference. Man is more for sense pleasure than for love. He appears to love to have the woman's bodily pleasures. A woman offers the bodily pleasures with the hope that the man will love her. Now the days have changed. Both may be pretending, both may be selfish. It may be always with full of exceptions. Love is pure without desire, without fear. Many women are afraid of the anger of the husband. Many men are afraid, either fear or desire, either in the worldly life or in the spiritual world. You love a person either because of a desire or because of a fear of punishment. In most offices, the boss is loved because tomorrow, if you do not show love, you may be dismissed, demoted, punished. These two are to be eliminated. Now, coming back to the point, there are three dimensions. One is Parinama Bhakti. Second is Bhavana Bhakti. Third is Anusthana Bhakti. Anusthana Bhakti is practical devotion. Bhavana Bhakti is attitudinal devotion. Parinama Bhakti is to take you from the lowest to the highest. And before we go to the other two, we shall try to see the Parinama Bhakti. Just sit and observe our own love. We love ourselves. We love ourselves. It is Atmanastukamaya Priyo Bhavati. statement from the Vedic wisdom, Upanishadic wisdom. Yajnavalkya speaks of this. Atmanastu kamaya priyo bhavati. Because I love myself, I want this body to be given the pleasure, therefore I love the wife. And I want to be looked after by my son, therefore I love the son. I want to be protected by somebody, therefore I love the God. Ultimate self-interest is topmost, self-centered. And that self is basically life, life, life. When our life is in danger, when we are in the tightest corner, we pray to that person who is capable of protecting our life, and that person is God. Doctors have declared hopeless. Nobody comes to our rescue. I am pushed to the corner. Yama is waiting. Anyatha sharanastitvameva sharanam mama. Oh God, come to my rescue, please save my life. Gajendra. Instinctive, animal-like, we are first and foremost to seek protection to our life. Whoever protects our life is loved. This is symbolically presented in Bhagavata Purana when we have the description of Gajendra. Animal-like, we want that self to be protected, life to be protected. Rave Ishwara Kalave Varada Samrakshinchu Bhadratmika Deevi. That elephant makes a fervent prayer to the Almighty. Lavo Kintayuledu Thayyam Vilolambaya Pranamula Thavundappe Moochavacche Shravambayadin Tanun Dessen Nivetappa Nirahvaram Virunga. Rave Ishwara, O God, wherever you are, whoever you may be, whatever may be your designation, please come to save me, my life. That is the first and foremost. When we make that fervent cry, sincere prayer, with absolute faith, sure that ultimate reality comes to us and saves our lives. This is the desire. And then, when once that desire is fulfilled, when we are saved, when the life is protected, next most important is our ego, self-respect. In most cases of the present day world, initially it is infatuation between boy and girl, and then when the man makes a bad statement about the woman, self-respect comes to the surface and she gives the divorce notice. Self-love. From the life to the egoism, self-respect, and from Gajendra way of worship, full of desire for protection of life, we come to the protection of self-respect. Life is trivial, self-respect is more important. There are many people committing suicide, death appears to be nothing. Self-respect is most important, and that is Draupadi. Gajendra's state of mind, the animal's state of mind, and then we come to Draupadi woman's self-respect. Mind evolves. When she is dragged to the public court hall to be disrobed in the broad daylight in the Darbar hall by that cruel rogue Dushasana, 10,000 people are present in the hall. Not a single fellow came to the rescue of that lady. When we are in distress, when we are being insulted, when we are being looked down upon, humiliated, nobody comes to our rescue. And then again, Draupadi, the mind, makes a fervent appeal to the Almighty, please come to my rescue. First, protection of life. Next, protection to the self-respect. Again, with full faith, Krishnancha Vishnuncha Harin Narancha Tranaya Vikroshati Agyashini Tatastu Dharmaha Antarita Samakrano Vividhai Suvastre. Wonderfully that God Almighty comes to the rescue of Draupadi to offer Akshaya Vastra. It is the second state, protection of the life, protection of the self-respect. Once I know a great person coming to me and say, he is a great person, he has given me life. He is a very, very, very great person, he has protected my self-respect. He loves me, he likes me. Why can't I make use of him for my fulfillment of desires? Sir, thank you very much, sir. You have saved my life that day, sir. You have saved my self-protection the other day, sir. I have seen in that market, sir, a beautiful diamond necklace, sir. Please get me, sir. I am suffering from poverty, sir. Please make me rich, sir. Sir, I don't have a job, sir. Please give me a job, sir. Ardharthi. Ato jinyasurardharthi jnani chavarandatrava. Initially, artha bhakti, in distress, in hopelessness, for the protection of life. Next, for the protection of self-respect. When you know the person who has given you these two protections, then you begin, and that is your Sudama or Kuchela. Kuchela's life is not in danger. His self-respect is not in danger. He is suffering from adversity. He has poverty. And therefore, he goes to Krishna. Krishna, money. Govinda, increment. Shiva, promotion. Then, that also with absolute faith, God grants. Third stage. Fulfillment of materialistic desires. And then, I am accustomed to have my desires fulfilled by the God. I love him because I love myself. That you should don't forget. Initially, I love life. I love self-respect. I love my belongings, promotions, increments, fulfillment of desires. Therefore, I love God. When I am evolving, he has given me promotion, but he has not given me transfer to my house, to my village. He has given me the husband whom I love most, but he has not blessed me with children. Everywhere, one is given, one is not given. Arjuna is a lover of Krishna. He surrendered his all at the feet of Krishna. On the 13th day of the Mahabharata Yuddha, Abhimanyu died. Arjuna's son is dead. Arjun goes to Krishna. Krishna, yes, what do you want? I want my son. Did Krishna grant life to Abhimanyu? No. Every time, everything will not be fulfilled by the Almighty. Kunti Devi went to Krishna. My dear nephew, yes, please protect my children. Certainly, Pancha Pandavas will be protected. No, they can protect, but Karna, no, he will not. He gives you one, he does not give you another. Then, should you be angry with him for not fulfilling your desire? Should you be faithful to him and continue to be his devotee because he has fulfilled many desires? He gave me job, he gave me promotion, he gave me increment, but he has not given me transfer to my village. Three plus points, one minus point. All of us experience the divine grace. We enjoy it. And then, why this man is playing with me? Why this God is giving me some, is not giving some? Then we begin to understand him. You probe deep. Uddhava asked Krishna, who are you? Why do you play with me? Why do you fulfill certain desires? What is our relationship? This is called inquiry. That also he has to clarify. And then he will get their understanding. Krishna says to Arjuna at the end, Arjuna, you are Nara, I am Narayana. I know my past, I know my present, I know my future. I know your past, I know your present, I know your future. I am yourself, you are myself. We both are Nara and Narayana, come on earth. We have to play a wonderful role. And now Arjuna's knowledge is wisdom. He glows, he shines. Krishna, now you have dispelled my moha. Nasto moha smurtir labdhaha girstitosmi gata sandeha karishye vachanam tava. Total absolute merging with the Almighty, and that is Prahlad. Prahlad did not ask God to protect his life. Prahlad did not ask God to protect his self-respect. Prahlad did not ask God to give the fulfillment of desires. Prahlad did not make inquiries. He just loved God. A flower blossoms, does it want recognition? It is its nature to be beautiful. It is the nature of man to be loving. When we become that all universal loving people, that is Bhakti. Advesta sarva bhutanam maitraha karma evacha nirmamo nirahankara. Sri Krishna describes the grandeur of a Bhakta who loves for the sake of love. When you love for the sake of money, when you love for the sake of protection of life, when you love for the sake of fulfillment of desires, when you love for the sake of acquisition of knowledge, it is only Bhakti. When you love for the sake of love, I love Mother India. Why? I love it. When you are in the bathroom, you sing a song. Why do you sing? I feel like singing, I sing. Do you get money? No. Do you get any grant? No. I feel like a flower blossoms. A man or woman loves. Love is the inner nature. When that nature comes out to the surface without any expectation, it is Bhakti. Are we boys and girls really premikas, lovers? Are we devotees really Bhakta yogis? Why should Narada Maharshi write Bhakti Sutras? Why should Sri Krishna Paramatma give a chapter to Bhakti Yoga? Why should there be Sri Ramakrishna Paramahamsa? Unless to explain what Bhakti Yogi is, a devotee, a lover, loves for the sake of love, sings for the sake of singing, speaks for the sake of singing, and art for the sake of art, worship for the sake of worship, work for the sake of work, knowledge for the sake of knowledge, that is the ultimate. It is something hidden in us. We are naturally loving people. So many desires are obstructing, so many fears are obstructing. When these bottlenecks are all removed, the love shines, blossoms, and that is your parinama bhakti. Artha jignasu rathardi jnana bhakti prahalasti. While loving, what is your attitude? How do you show that love? We shall try to see later. Now, Sri Krishna Paramatma is an ideal devotee, and let us meditate on it.
Oh, Thank you.